Warning, this is not a regular episode of For Fun Flyer.
No, it's not.
And not a live stream video too.
Yeah, you're not on the wrong YouTube channel. You're watching For Fun Flyer.
Let's get on with it.
Well, okay, let's get back to work.
Hi everyone, welcome back to a special episode of For Fun Flyer. Today with a well-known engineer slash pilot as my guest. You might have a clue who he is, but without spoiling the surprise, here's the intro video of his YouTube channel.
It's physics, math, and engineering. Machine it, draft it, build it, test it, break it. Every time something new gets built, the entire world advances. Laying in bed at night, it's designing new parts, designing new suspension, designing new wings.
It's great to see you, and as I said earlier, it's so awesome that you took the effort and time to talk to me and do this interview on my tiny YouTube channel For Fun Flyer. So welcome to the show.
Thank you. I'm really excited to be here. Thanks for the invite.
Yeah, and also, as I said earlier, you're just, to me at least, and I know there's a lot of folks out there, you're a really big inspiration and an example in the combination of building stuff, engineering stuff, and aviation. So
that's very kind. Thank you.
So on the off chance that people don't know who you are, and I think it's a really small chance, but can you introduce yourself to the viewers?
Yeah, sure. My name is Mike Patey. I'm from a family of 13. I'm an identical twin brother right in the middle of the pack. So yes, all those kids came from the same husband and wife, my mom and dad. They're still with me. They're amazing. They taught us all how to work hard, and we've always loved joy of building things. So I've been building things my whole life since I was, my mom said the biggest mistake she ever had was leaving a screwdriver down when I was like 2 years old. I figured out it goes into things and you can pull stuff apart. And that was kind of the beginning of my, I want to rip things apart and rebuild it days. So my background's engineering. My passion is aviation. And I've been building and racing things from go-karts when I was tiny, learning to weld when I was 8 years old. And kind of came up from there, and I went through the route from drag racing, circle track, Indy, hill climb to hill climb championship. Oddly enough, I was the first guy to put a bullet bike motor into a drag race hill climb championship tournament bike. And that kind of migrated up until I wanted to go faster and faster. And then I found aviation about 20 years ago.
Okay.
And when I found aviation, that was it. I was hooked. I mean, I'm an avid aviation nut. And I found that once you get airborne, life is just unreal. It's the greatest passion, the greatest love of my life, second to my wife and kids.
Yeah,
only.
Of course.
And so I love to build and race and design unique aircraft. So that's probably about the fastest way I could summarize this crazy nut, Mike.
Yeah, okay. And did you, in that whole process, do anything with RC aviation too? Because it's almost like a natural step from engineering to becoming a full-scale pilot?
Yeah, so my RC days were back when I was about 13 through about 16.
Okay.
And I played a lot with RCs and liked building my own modified RC aircraft and crashing one and then taking the parts and adapting it to a different crashed one. And so I had a lot of fun with that. And there's something about aviation got me hooked there. I remember I had spent forever building a giant Cessna 206. Oh, I mean, okay. It was a very large gas-powered 206. And it was balsa wood and kind of old school scratch build. And I screwed up on the build. And on the first flight, I was flying it. Everything was perfect. And I thought, I'll pull a big loop. And I pulled a loop. And then I'll pull a tighter one. And at one point, the whole tail exploded off the back of my plane on the first flight doing loops. And it was up pretty high. And as it started going to the ground, my buddies around me said, "Oh no, Mike, I'm so sorry." And I looked at him and I laughed. I said, "Hold on, watch this." And I just wrapped that gas power motor full throttle and then hit the aileron, which was still working. The tail was gone. It was pointed straight at the ground.
Okay.
I hit the throttle, wound it up, and spun that thing because I knew it was going to be destroyed. There was no hope for it. It was coming down straight. And I said, you know, if it's going out, let's go out in style. So I wound the coal to it, and I stuck that motor about 8 inches into the dirt. It was just absolutely a spectacular explosion of pieces. And I just laughed. And I thought, you know what? You can have fun building it. You can have fun breaking it. You can have fun rebuilding it. Yeah. And it's aviation is a blast and a journey. And so, I don't know, I've been hooked ever since.
You're such a positive guy. And actually, that's one of the quotes of a buddy of mine, that you don't necessarily have to enjoy aviation, but if you have a bad day, or if you're down, just go ahead and watch one of the videos of Mike Patey.
That's awesome.
But it's nice to see that you at an early age you already had that same personality, that same character of you know what, if something breaks, I learn something in the process and get to do it all over again and make something better even. That's something that was already there, or
it was just from my parents. Parents. I grew up really, really poor. I mean, you hear people say that. But a family of 13, my dad was a sign painter, hand painting signs. This is back before all the technology, where he hand painted paper signs that went in grocery stores saying the sales of the local fruits and vegetables and things like that.
Okay.
And he's feeding a family of 13. And so growing up, you know, we wore our shoes hand-me-downs. And then when the rubber was missing, my mom would cut out cardboard and put duct tape on them and stick them in the shoe because there was a hole this big in the main sole, and it was to protect our what socks we had.
Oh, yeah.
So we grew up poor but happy. My parents taught us how to work, how to love, passion for life, and it didn't matter how struggling we were. We always had food.
Mm-hmm.
It may have been puffed wheat and not much porridge every day for a while, but that wasn't our whole lives, but for most of our growing up years. But our dad taught us how to work hard, how to love work, and how to love the accomplishment, how to enjoy the process.
Yeah, yeah.
Whether it was digging trenches in the yard or working on the family garden or building a retaining wall, it didn't matter if I was running trenches for a sprinkler. My dad made it enjoyable as a family. We laughed, we joked, we threw rocks. We just found love in work.
Oh, okay, yeah.
And then a greater love of completion of a project, which I've held my whole life, that the harder the project, the more the challenge, the more the reward end, when you can snap back and say, hey, look at that.
Yeah.
Look what I did. I built this, I put in a sprinkler system. And then later I built a cool airplane. And so that for me, it's the passion of the build, the passion of completing the build, you know. That's my parents. I owe it all to them.
You started pretty early on as an entrepreneur together with your twin brother, as I saw in previous interviews and articles. Did you do any engineering education in between, or how did that go?
So I would think most of my engineering background was just because I had a passion for building from a toddler up. And so it was a self-taught process through my teenage years, and then into high school, I started taking more courses that led to mathematics and physics and engineering. And so in the classes, they kind of have a pretty regimented path. And the pace was a little slow.
Okay.
For what I wanted to learn. And it was so pointed at a specific target, whether it was electrical engineering, mechanical engineering, structural engineering, fluid dynamics.
Okay.
You could get stuck in one so long that you miss some of the others. So what I found on my engineering background, as I went to school and I started in college, I started in construction and engineering and structural buildings. And at some point, I realized that with technology of computer and the modern day and all the resources out there, I decided I didn't want to focus on one engineering facet.
Oh, yeah.
I wanted to learn all the engineering facets I could, from electrical to structural. And so I at the time I was in college, I had about 200 employees at that point.
Wow.
19 years old. We had started a company when we were 15 years old. My dad went blind when we were 15. Oh. So he could no longer sign paint.
Oh, okay.
And so my twin brother and I started our company building decks. 19, I'm in college with a couple hundred employees. And I realized that between, I would work double shifts with my guys when I could and going to college. I thought, at this speed, I'm never going to learn electrical, mechanical, structural, fluid dynamics all at the same time. The program doesn't work that way for me at college. So I just started doing courses and studying books myself. And I never got a degree in any of them.
Okay.
Because I left college at that point, wanting to learn all of them. But kind of that's my background of engineering, was a little bit of college and then self-taught from there.
There are three airplanes sticking out above the rest. But perhaps we can discuss these three airplanes real quick and see what they were, etc. And to start off with those airplanes, Turbulence. This is just a really awesome looking airplane with a turboprop engine, and I like everything with a turbine engine in it or on it. So can you tell a bit about that airplane, what it was and what you did with it?
So Turbulence was based on a Lancair Legacy. I had built several Lancair Legacies, piston versions, turbine versions. Turbulence had two different engine packages, complete redo. But I took a Lancair Legacy. I took things I had learned on several past legacies. And I built a custom wing, converted it to a twin spar instead of a single, made it a single piece wing from tip to tip rather than a disassemblable wing.
Okay.
Reinforced it at a severe magnitude in carbon fiber and skin thickness and everything else. Changed the wing tips, changed the length. So it had a custom wing, custom tail, larger tail, larger vertical, larger horizontal. Of course, the big thing, I put a Pratt Whitney PT6 -42 alpha on it, which is 1,090 thermal dynamic horsepower, a gearbox limited to 850. So it's 850 usable horsepower, but because the thermal limit was 1,090, it could hold 850, clear up into the mid-teens. It was a plane that had a sustained climb rate. I had some video one day, I had to make footage on it. I have video of it racing a jet, an Eclipse jet out there somewhere.
Oh, yeah.
But at that point, it had the smaller motor, a -28. It was 680 horse,
okay.
Which that motor ended up going in Draco. But I upgraded it to the -42. I don't have any footage of that plane flying with the bigger motor. Or I have footage, I just haven't put it out. But that plane could sustain 7,000 feet a minute, sustained climb rate. Not trading speeds for altitude, just point and shoot on rotation. Yeah. A cruise speed of 380 knots, no problem. Yeah. Sometimes winter faster, but a range of well over 1,000 miles. And so that was a really fun plane. I there was a whole lot more I did to it, but I may be boring you. But that was my little rocket ship.
Yeah, nice. And then with that airplane, you actually broke some record. What was that again?
Yeah, so it holds the world's fastest single-engine turboprop record that's flying today. It's the fastest single-engine turbine flying today. It also broke the record at Air Venture Cup, which has been the large air race for the public racing to Air Venture Oshkosh. Because it's about 400 to 500-mile race, depending on which direction they're running that year, mm-hmm. You can't use water and ADI sprayers. And it's who's the fastest in the world without an engine that is only going to last 8 to 10 minutes, because they're going to run out of ADI injection, water sprayers, they're overboosted, and their engine's going to grenade. Let's see who can actually have a plane that can go 400 miles at what speed. And so it's really fun. Only one guy in history had ever broke the 400 mile an hour race record in 20 years. And that was 8 or 9 years ago.
Okay.
And that was in a really fast turbine Legend with a instead of a 750 horse motor, they put a 1,000 horsepower motor in it. And he had raced that event like 7 times, and one time he hit 401.2 miles an hour. So one person had ever broke the 400 mile an hour mark on a closed course, couple of turn legs, real world race. And I was fortunate enough, my first time there with Turbulence with the big motor in it, I became the second pilot to break that record at 438 miles an hour. So
400,
that is still
438.
438 miles an hour. And that race is timed from a dead stop right at the airport. So your whole climb out, and the cross of the finish line is a flyover, but it's not like you get up to speed and dive in and get full speed and they clock you. You actually take off the runway, and partway down the runway, they tag you. So your whole climb out, the whole route, the turns, everything is part of it. So my average was 438 miles an hour. So that was a fun plane. I am building a plane to beat it.
Oh, really?
So that is coming up
soon. With a propeller or a jet engine? Well,
it will be a turboprop, but it's going to be a next level madness. I'm underway on it. I've been doing the engineering on it while I've been working on Scrappy. So this time we're going with a 67 Papa, which just came out from Pratt Whitney.
Okay.
It's a motor that's only flying in the newest Pilatus PC-12. And so it's actually a near 1,800 horsepower motor, derated to 1,200 on the gearbox.
Okay.
So unlike Turbulence had 850 on the gearbox, I now have 1,200 on the gearbox. But because the motor is near 1,800 horse on the thermodynamic level, this aircraft will be able to hold 1,200 continuous up into the upper flight levels. So it's it's going to be...
Interesting.
It's going to be insane. I'm pressurizing this one. This will be a pressurized hot rod for 35,000 foot capable. And we're gonna say goodbye to my old race speed of 380 knot cruise. And we're gonna put it significantly north of that.
So is this actually a scoop? Did you ever share this story to someone else? Or
this is an inside scoop for you. I think I may have whispered it out there a time or two. But I don't know that I've really been this public with that that little tidbit of an up-and-coming aircraft, and I'm getting really excited about it.
So, the second airplane on my list that the airplane people know best from you, and that's of course Draco. So, again, on the off chance that the people don't know Draco, I think that the chance is really, really, really small. But can you talk a bit about Draco?
So Draco, I bought the first Wilga that showed up at Oshkosh with the new variants and came out in 2006. And when I saw it at AirVenture Oshkosh, I fell in love with it. I said, man, that is so cool. And man, wouldn't it be great if it had bigger tires? And I started fantasizing about this thing. So I bought serial number one of the new variant in 2006. Loved the aircraft and quickly learned great performer, great plane. But I live in really high and hot elevations in the places I go. It was just a little bit anemic for what I wanted. And ultimately, I thought, you know, I'll sell it, and later, maybe someday, I'll do something. I sold it, and then they stopped building them. It took me 10 years to find. Several years, I just let it go, and then I started looking. It took me several years to find the last serial number ever made, and that's what became Draco. And I bought that with the intent to do all these ideas I had when I had my first one. So bigger wing, bigger tail, bigger horizontal. Bigger gear, bigger suspension, big motor, more fuel, more range, larger wing, larger cord, leading cuff. The list goes on and on, and we won't bore you, but ultimately we took off a piston and put in a Pratt & Whitney turbine, which was the Dash 28 that used to be in Turbulence, the plane we just talked about. The Turbulence had, it was originally a piston, went to a Dash 28 turbine, then went to the Dash 32, and that's when I did even the bigger tail. So that motor migrated from my hangar into Draco and became, I had no idea people would find so much love and affection for it like I did. So it was a beautiful plane. It was a really sad day when I crashed it and lost it, but I'm going to bring it back.
Yeah, because that's one of the things on my list too. I wanted to talk about the crash, but also the resurrection of Draco. You made this little, almost cinematic kind of little clip from Draco X or something. Can you share something on that? Or
so Draco X is going to be the rebuild of Draco, and it is not the rebuild of the original airframe. The damage was severe enough that there's a few components I just wasn't willing to take the risk on.
Okay.
So I do have a new airframe, big white new Draco future Draco aircraft. I haven't started on it yet, but the plane is here at the hangar, and I have started the concept. So basically, Draco X stands for 10, and I'm doing 10 significant improvements. There'll probably be others, but there are 10 significant things. I'm even going to a larger wing. I'm adding an additional wing spar. I'm adding more fuel. I'm increasing the gross weight. I'm building a bigger horizontal. But I'm going a much bigger motor, which is always fun. So we're gonna do the same thing we did with Turbulence, which was go from a 680 horse to a much larger. Draco is gonna go from its 680 horse to near 1,000. And I think we'll have close to 1,000 horsepower. We'll be right there on the 1-to-1 thrust to weight ratio range. So it's gonna be fun.
Yeah, that's those ratios. You only see those in RC planes, right? You can just hold it by the tail, full throttle, and you just let it go like fireworks. But that's insane on a full scale airplane. But
it's usually RC or afterburners. And so I thought, you know, let's see if we can get close to 1-to-1 with normal power.
Yeah, but
that'll make for a fun airplane.
But I think that there's a lot of engineering complexities to that, because the prop wash on those type of ratios,
the peak factor, the roll tendency, the everything that starts to happen, and so even which engine I use is critical. For example, I couldn't put in, and I'm not ripping on this brand, it's just there's a difference. I couldn't put a Garrett engine in the new Draco because Garrett, all the components rotate the same direction inside the motor, including the prop. And so the gyroscopic effect of having excess horsepower on a tiny aircraft would want to wrap it up the other way. So all your P factors and all your turning tendencies would be amplified by the actual physics or design of the motor itself. Yeah. There's nothing wrong with that motor, but Pratt & Whitney's is different. The front and the back sections of the turbines are counter-rotating, so they offset. So though one of those sections rotates the same direction of the propeller, at least you don't have all the pressure chamber, the combustion chamber, the gearbox, and the prop all going the same way. They alternate, and it helps. So there's lots of engineering. I probably bored you. We've been telling you that, but that's just one of so many things that you have to bring into play when you start putting horsepower at that level into an aircraft that flies that slow.
Yeah, exactly.
Now, if you had that horsepower in a small airplane that went really fast, well, you just wouldn't throw all the throttle to it. You'd wrap it up. But if you got up enough speed, it's okay. But to try and do it at a plane that can fly slow and you want to accelerate quickly, it's a whole nother level of fun design, physics, engineering. And so we're going to dive all into that on Draco X.
And the third one on my list of airplanes is, of course, Scrappy. November 780, Mike, right?
Yes, sir.
So, what can you tell us about that project?
Okay, so Scrappy, I have so many build parts. I wanted to build Scrappy out of scrap parts, but I didn't want it to look like a scrap build plane. So the idea was, how much scrap material do I have around? How much scrap chromoly? What kind of frame? I had a bent frame and a fairly good frame at. I had good components that weren't bent, ailerons and elevators and rudder, but of course, none of them would work. They'd have to be bigger. So it was a lot of scrap material, some new components, but throughout the motor was it was an old motor out of my race plane, so it's not even a new motor. So it was like, how can I take all the parts I have around my shop and build something radical, but then throw in modern avionics, all new carbon fiber, machine some parts, and at the end of the day, I want to have a plane that is air show worthy, you know, Lindy worthy, hopefully would be nice, out of mostly scrap components. And so that's Scrappy. We're trying to push the envelope on all kinds of things with a push
plane. Yeah, that's fun. What was it that the project meant to be in a back-to-back project with your twin brother?
Yes, so Mark was going to build some six-cylinder. His company, he runs our Best Checks company. Yeah. I run a couple of our other companies. And that's been growing so fast. And we built a brand new factory. It's our fourth factory enlargement. And he's growing like crazy.
Okay.
And so during the factory build, he just hasn't had time. The engine's on the front of his. He's got a six-cylinder, like homing in a cub. But he hasn't, the last few months, he hasn't had a chance. He's going to dive back into it. My aircraft is, as you know, is an eight-cylinder Lycoming. It's the only eight-cylinder, 780 cubic inch Lycoming in the world. I custom made that. I had to find a wide deck case, open up the case to fit the big pistons that make a 360, a 390, makes a 720, a 780. So it's the only 780. I made my own induction, my own intake, headlockers, bunch of machine components for my race days. Why not put it in a cup? Yeah, everything had to change. I sit where normally a back seat would be, but it's still a two-seat cub. Another person sits behind me. But it not only did I fit it in there, I had to widen the fuselage. But when you get in it, it's a very roomy, extremely comfortable cub. It's I'm really happy with how it's going. I got some really cool stuff coming really soon. I'll give you a sneak verbal description of something coming out. I don't know if your video will be out before I release it, but the front suspension is done on Scrappy.
Oh, okay.
And the front suspension is like nothing ever been done on an aircraft before. I went over the top, and there's lots of reasons for it, and I'll get into it on an up-and-coming video. But it is certainly out there, and it's really exciting. It's more akin to a Baja Super Trophy truck or a Desert Sand Rail. But it is some really long travel, made to take the biggest ditches, rocks, boulders you could ever imagine, and pound right through it. So my brother Mark has seen it. It's coming out real soon, of course, and others that have snuck into my hangar and have seen a sneak peek. The general consensus of almost anyone that shows up and sees it is Mike, if we're ever going flying and we're not sure about the spot, the weeds are tall, we can't see the rocks, Mike, we're just sending Scrappy in. He won't care. Scrappy just might go first. Then you can pick up the boulders, move them out of the way, and let us know where to land. So the idea is a plane that can really take a hit. Do you want a sneak peek? I'm going to back up. It's just going to be a flash.
Okay.
I don't know if anyone will be able to zoom in and see it. It's not up the gear. There's a sneak peek. I'm kind of it's really far away. I don't think anyone can see it, but there you go.
It's way too blurry. Cool.
There you go. Probably see it. There's a sneak peek of my panel. Yeah. You've already seen some of the panel, but it's come further away. But
yeah.
But I'm doing. If I show too close on it, you'd see some other secrets that are coming out real soon.
Oh, okay.
But,
no. Just, anyway, I don't want to.
Scrappy's coming along really well. I'm a little behind on my videos.
Well, it's nice to share that on YouTube, because I know I've been doing these YouTube videos for a little over a year now, and it's just a lot of work. So, and that was basically one of my first questions as well. How do you get to combine this all? Do you just sleep like 2 or 3 hours a night?
No, so I don't need a lot. I don't need a lot of sleep, but I think my body was just trained at a younger age when I started my companies. I would work 2 8-hour shifts and then go play, and so my days were long. And then I think my body adapted to where when I go to sleep, we did some tests to make sure I'm healthy and safe.
Okay,
and
yeah.
I don't have any sleeping disorder. I don't have any kind of unique physical thing. I think I just trained that when I go to bed, I kind of skip the step down to sleep, and I just go right to the deepest level of sleep. And when I wake up right out of the deepest level of sleep. So I get really good sleep.
Okay.
I don't sleep as much as most. But then like the videos and stuff, they take time. But what I do, I used to make all my own videos. Now I film them all. I kind of clip them together. And then I have a friend, Chris, great guy, and I send them over to him, and he puts some music in it and fine tunes it. And so that saves me the time. So I would make them myself, but then Scrappy would go slower, and so would the next secret aircraft coming. And so Draco.
We can't have that, of course. No. yeah, it was just really nice to hang out with you and to hear your story. And for Front Flyer, my YouTube channel is all about sharing the passion for aviation. And if someone is passionate about aviation, I think it's you. So thanks again for joining. And I really, really appreciate it that you said yes to this interview. Thank you very much.
For all of you out there, be safe, have fun, work hard, go after your passions. Life is amazing. And even in your worst day, you can find a way to be excited, be happy, and enjoy life. So hang in there, go for it, tackle those goals, and then get back to work.
That's it for this episode of A Fun Flyer, the interview with Mike Patey. And on the off chance you didn't check out his videos yet, there's a link to his YouTube channel down below in the description of my episode. So go ahead and subscribe to his channel and follow him along on all the other social media channels.
Hey guys, if you like this video, there's a lot more out there. This guy is awesome. Subscribe, like, follow him, his other social media channels. He's all about aviation. That's what we all love. So I hope you follow him.